Good day, students. Welcome to Game for PGs. What does the word game mean? Gross and microscopy explain. In this session, I shall try to approach the lesions of the kidney and the method of handling it, the questions that can be asked regarding the kidney itself. It is a trial and I would very much solicit your feedback. Designing and doing are two different things, yet multiple is the outcome in different pairs of hands. Always we know that when there are two different surgeons, the outcome is different. It may be subtle or it can be obvious. A grossing station. These are all newly being designed and we should pay ample attention to all this. Whether there is a flow of water, whether you have got the containers, different sets of instruments are available, so on and so forth. And then there has to be a grossing table as such, in which we do it. A lot of intricacies are there which you people can learn from each other or from your seniors. When in doubt, display. If it is going to be an organ, what are all the things that we should concentrate on? And these are the subheadings. I would like you people to kindly pay attention as to whether we are covering a good number of them. The kidney, as I had said, a normal anatomy. You need not be as perfect as an anatomist, but to some extent, we should be. Definitely, they will be asking you the size of the kidney, the weight of the kidney. How do you say it is kidney? So on and so forth. So, there is the renal parenchyma. There is the hilum over here. What are the structures coming out of the hilum? Is there any mnemonic for it and so on? And how do you distinguish between the right adrenal and the left? These are the things. The type of specimen. You may be given a gross specimen for description and discussion, or it can be an assembled autopsy. In this case, obviously, I find that it has been removed totally, therefore the patient is no longer alive. So also in this case, the situation appears to be very bad. Patchy areas of purulent exudate. Therefore, it is an autopsy specimen. And in this case, it is a horseshoe kidney. Therefore, the question can be, what are all the congenital anomalies that can be present? So this is one set of specimens. Another one, it can be a surgical specimen. So a transplantation, it is underway. And look at the care with which the specimen is being handled. And when it does come to us, it can be a case of a graft rejection. It is an acute rejection or so on. And how do you people make a diagnosis? I am pertinently giving these two examples because they are poles apart. In one, you have got an emergency role. In another, you will have to have a patient to study the details. This is what I had sent earlier. Size, something that I had read earlier, which will be useful. 4.5 into 2.5 into 1.5 inches. But if it is going to be centimeters, kindly measure. Shape is bean shape. And we should be a little careful whenever we use the word bean shape. Kidneys are bean shaped. Lymph nodes are bean shaped. Beans are kidney shaped. Ovaries are kidney shaped. Any structure that has got a hilum will be bean shaped in outline for the entry and the exit of the structures. The weight is about 150 grams. There is a capsule and a fascia. This I would like you people to kindly appreciate. A renal parenchyma is here. There is a capsule. There is a perinephric fat covering which is the gerota species. So what are all the different coverings you people should know? Because when there is going to be a case of a malignancy, to what extent should we study is of paramount importance. And what are all the adjoining structures? We shall diagrammatically be seeing them later on. The fundamental anatomy you people should know. So this is the renal parenchyma. There is a cortex, there is a medulla. This we call as corticomedullary differentiation. So in a specimen, you will have to tell the examiners whether the corticomedullary differentiation is well made out, preserved, or there is a damage to it, something has happened. Also, within the parenchyma, are you able to see any lesion? All specimens need not be neoplastic. And there is a callus and a pair of calluses over here, and then there is a pelvis. And there can be the minor calluses as well. These polar calluses are of great importance because these will be affected whenever there is going to be a regurgitation or a reflux of urine. So this will be affected in the case of a pyelonephritis. Have these in mind, we shall be seeing them. Also the lymph nodes. The lymph nodes, generally we will be getting a specimen, and in any of the tumors, they'll be asking you what are the routes of spread. What are the lymph nodes to be studied? So in this case, it can be perihilar, precaval, paracaval, retrocaval, and interaortocaval. So there are so many groups of lymph nodes, just memorize them. Just memorize. So this is a pyelonephritis. Pyelonephritis, as I had been mentioning earlier, there can be widening of the pelvis, widening of the calyx, there can be blunting of the calluses. They say whenever there is a regurgitation or a reflux, it goes to the poles. And as a result of which, there can be blunting of the calluses. And because of this, there can be an impingement, there can be an inflammation, as a result of which there is a scarring. Therefore, whenever we give a bit from a kidney, we are supposed to sample the poles of the kidney, which is mandatory. Secondly, you find that the entire kidney will not be uniformly affected, as a result of which there can be coarse, irregular scars. Third, inflammation is chronic, and therefore there will be a fibrinous exudate, and therefore there can be an addition of the capsule. And secondly, any such exudate will lead to opacity of the clear capsule. Therefore, it is not transparent. It can be unilateral or bilateral. Unilateral, one example is if there is going to be a renal stone in the ureter on one side, that can be. A tumor that is impinging on one ureter, that can be a unilateral pyelonephritis. Bilateral, when the obstruction is going to be lower down, chronic prostatic hyperplasia, posterior urethral valve, etc. And whatever be it, it is asymmetrical. Dilatation of the pelvic calyceal system. There's a coarse inner surface, blunting of the calluses, polar calluses are involved. And there is atrophy of the parenchyma at the corresponding regions. Be very strong and assertive when you people give a diagnosis. In this specimen, obviously, it is not very healthy. There has been some damage that has been done. I find that there is a rounding of the calluses and there is a distension of the pelvis. Accordingly, there can be atrophy of the parenchyma adjoining the calyx. The infarct or the trauma, again, we people should know. Kidney is one organ with an end artery, and then there can be a lot of these blood vessels which are circumventing the parenchyma called the arcuate arteries. Therefore, any of the obstruction over here can lead to a massive necrosis. There is no collateral circulation. In your topic on infarct, the kidney is a classical example of an end artery. There is also an afferent arteriole. Sometimes you can have blood vessels from the capillaries, some capsules are all, which are seeping inside. So trauma, it can be because of a hematoma. Subcapsular hematoma can be over there. A blunt injury is adequate to cause it. Whereas an infarct, it will be more wedge shape. It is wedge shape because there is a blood vessel or a branch and it divides and redivides. As a result of which, the area of supply itself is wedge shaped, and hence any infarct in a solid parenchyma is wedge shaped. That is why you get wedge shaped infarct in solid parenchyma. You must remember this. Obviously, we'll have to look for some obstruction somewhere when we do an autopsy. This is another one, a classical wedge-shaped infarct. That's what I had been telling you people. So whenever there is an obstruction over here, this is just like the delta of a river. There is branching and rebranching. All these are affected, as a result of which there is an infarct which is triangular. Initially, it is congested, and later on, when there is the phagocytosis of the RBCs, it becomes pale in color. Whatever be it, please remember Dixon. The greatest fool can ask more questions than the wisest man can answer. And this is a special type of renal necrosis. I find that the renal pyramid, part of it is being necrosed, whereas the remaining is viable. Part is necrosed, remaining is viable. Generally, they say 1/3 can be necrosed, remaining 2/3 is viable, or vice versa. This happens in a case of necrotizing papillitis, in a case of diabetic kidney. So what are all the different types of necrosis you people should be able to mention? Sampling of a kidney. Obviously, tumor bits will have to be given. That is why an external description. This is again an area where the students fumble. The shape of the kidney, in one area I'm finding that it is bosselated. You'll have to measure the region of bosselation, mention something about the rest of the kidney, and whether there any hyla structure. These are all important because the kidney tumor can spread via the ureter, via the renal vein into the inferior vena cava, etc. And therefore, all these will have to be sampled. And when you go to the cut surface, obviously there is an adrenal. This has to be considered because it is a clear gland, and therefore the renal tumor is also called the clear cell tumor. It was mistaken for the adrenal tumor, hence the name hypernephroma. The sampling has to be done, including the capsule, including the fat, including the gerotus fascia, if required. And look at this bit over here, as I had mentioned earlier, taken somewhere far away, but then this region is important because of the ureteric reflux. There can be a pyelonephritis developing in this region. And any other region, you will have to give. The kidney, particularly the renal cell carcinoma, you people will be knowing the variegated appearance. There can be areas of necrosis, yellowish areas of fat, areas of hemorrhage, so on. Therefore, multiple bits will have to be given. There can be solid areas, cystic areas, etc. Therefore, sampling is required. If it is going to be solid, homogeneous, uniform, then multiple bits are not mandatory. Look at this one, a super picture, again taken from the net. The yellowish color that I have been telling you people, there are areas of hemorrhage. It appears well circumscribed, but sometimes we can be having small nodules outside, which are called satellite nodules. So seemingly circumscribed, but not benign. So well planned is half done. So you'll have to, before even giving the pits, have some kind of a subheading. So identify, you measure, you describe, the normal kidney is over here. What about the perinephric fat? What about the capsule? Size of the tumor, shape, etc. From where all you are going to give the bits, diagram is always mandatory. For students, postgraduate students, please develop this habit. Draw a diagram so that your colleague or the faculty will not have any doubt whatsoever about what you have done. So this is from web pathology, I had mentioned over here. What are all the areas? The fascia, etc., the normal kidney. Along with that, the ureter, the pelvis, lymph nodes, blood vessels. Look at the massive difference between this. And more important is I find that there is an invasion of the vein of the ureter, and this also will have to be sampled. Sometimes in a case of a renal cell carcinoma, there can be a solid snake-like growth going into the renal vein, into the inferior vena cava, ascending up to the right side of the heart. What I had mentioned earlier, the various bits that you people will have to give. This is something that is important. What is the relationship? What are all the various structures adjoining? For example, there is an abdominal muscle over here. And then there is a fascia, which is called the gerator's fascia. This is a fat. And then there is a capsule. Earlier, when I was an undergraduate student, I had read that the pad kidneys lie in the lumbar region behind the peritoneum, one on either side of the vertebral column, in the upper part of the abdominal cavity. Such should be the fluency that you people should develop when you are answering. And always look at the chain of the lymph nodes. Around the renal vein itself, there can be the lymph node, and then it goes. There are the various groups of nodes which I had mentioned. And the structures you people will have to identify. The renal artery, the renal vein, ureter. If you go too near the trees, you lose track of the woods. So have an aerial view or a distant view. You will be able to make a diagnosis. So in this case, I am finding that there is a tumor which is bulging, which is homogeneous, which is fleshy, and not exactly in the pole. In fact, the mother would have been able to palpate this particular mass, so she takes the child to the doctor. This is a case of a Wilms tumor. And when it is yellowish in color, almost as good as fat, you will have to think of an angiomyolipoma. So a beautiful picture, netmids is the source, a kidney having a tumor, there are solid as well as cystic areas, a variegated appearance, invasion of the renal vein going into the inferior vena cava, and these are all the paracaval group of lymph nodes. Beautiful corticomedullary differentiation. It is well retained over here, but bits will have to be given from all these. And we do not know whether it is a right kidney or a left kidney once it is removed. As a result of which, conventionally, people used to leave a longer ureter for the right side and a shorter one for the left side. So that later on, when there is some pathology, they will be able to exactly locate whether it is a right or the left. Old habits die hard. You should be lavish in your descriptions, as though you are praising your would-be fiancé. Amyloidosis, that's what I used to say. The kidney is enlarged. It is pale. It is glistening. It is waxy. It is smooth. Not difficult to cut. And myeloma kidney also can be there, because myeloma itself is one of the cause for amyloidosis. AL amyloid can be present. And coming to the enlarged kidney, it can be bulging because of hydronephrosis. It can be a polycystic kidney. An adult polycystic, it will be having a bosselated appearance. Whereas an infantile, it will be having radial cyst, not difficult to make out when it is cut, but external surface can be uniform. Tumor, these are all the things that you people will have to remember. So this is a description of an amyloid kidney. Waxy can be a word. Pale, smooth, shiny, etc. Flea-bitten kidney is another one. Kindly remember what are all the conditions possible. The classical one is malignant hypertension. Endocarditis, quite rare. Hemolytic uremia syndrome. Polyarteritis nodosa. And TTP. Rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis. PTP is thrombotic, thrombocytopenic purpura. So you are finding pinpoint areas of hemorrhage. And this is a beautiful picture from Pure Digital. It's a fantastic source. I would like you people to all go and benefit from it. In a malignant hypertension, there can be areas of hemorrhage, but beyond that, there can be two histological findings. There is a periarteriolar onion skin appearance, or in some cases there can be a fibrinoid necrosis, and there will be areas of hemorrhage. Look at this one beautifully. At the corticomedullary junction, there are areas of hemorrhage. And essential hypertension or malignant hypertension is 300 by 150 millimeters of mercury. Contracted kidney, this is what I had been telling you people earlier, whether it is bilateral or unilateral. Bilateral means whether it is symmetrical or asymmetrical. If it is going to be symmetrical, think of glomerulonephritis, nephrosclerosis. There will be a V-shaped scar that can be seen. And in a case of a pyelonephritis, there can be a U-shaped scar. Senile ischemia, later stages of amyloidosis. Amyloidosis, it is enlarged, but later on there is fibrosis, there is contraction. If it is going to be unilateral, it can be a unilateral obstruction or it can be a hypoplastic kidney. This is a case of a benign nephrosclerosis. Fine granular contractions are there and it is bilateral symmetrical. And look at the pyelonephritis, you will be able to appreciate the difference. And there can be a thickening of the vessel wall. There can be sclerosis of the glomeruli seen in a case of glomerulonephritis. Xanthogranulomatosis, you find that there will be yellowish areas which are seen, typical of xanthogranulomatosis. It is actually a variant of chronic pyelonephritis in which you will be able to see large clear cells. And look at the multiple calculi. This is a typical Stagon calculus. And why it is Stagon? Because it is an image or it is a cast of the pelvic ischial system. Therefore, it has got this kind of an appearance. Hydronephrosis can be a specimen. It can be congenital. It can be acquired. And look at this one. There is a distension. There is a coalition of the various calyces. And then there is a atrophy, but I'm not seeing the fibrosis, etc. And in fact, the inner wall will be smooth. Whereas in a pyelonephritis, it will be rough and ragged. A horseshoe kidney is one. These are all difficult to find for us. It has been detected by means of an MRI. Cystic diseases of the kidney. You may be given a specimen of polycystic kidney. It can be part of an assembled autopsy. But then they can ask you, what are all the various other cystic diseases? Kindly have the entire list. Your Robbins gives a beautiful tabular column. And you people should be able to at least mention the different types. Do not forget that there can be parasitic cysts such as the hydatid cyst. There can be tumor with a cystic degeneration, or there can be vascular lesions also. Please mention these. I would advise you people again to go back to rats in which I have described the cystic diseases, the development of the cyst, etc. It is for undergraduate that I have taken, but it would very well suit the needs of the postgraduate. End stage kidney. The kidney is of no use at all. They have removed it and it is sent. But in this particular case, it has been a graft. And then look at this one. It is a grafted kidney. From here, they had given a connection to the urinary bladder. There has been a failure. And then there is a lot of the sclerosis over here. And sometimes it can mimic a pyelonephritis. It is not of great importance for you as students, but for pathologists, we should be able to distinguish between an end-stage kidney and a chronic pyelonephritis. In both, we can see the lymphocytes. Thyroidization can be seen. So, this is a beautiful sketch that I have drawn, and itself, it is called a spiral notebook. Kindly go to this reference. You may be able to get multiple diagrams of various organs. And this is what I had been mentioning about the relations. Again, a beautiful picture, kindly go through. Is it clear? So what are all the structures, where it is being located, where is the artery, vein, and what can we expect in the examination? These are all the things that you people will have to see. And size, identification, contraction, enlarged, cystic lesions, questions on the capsule, types of infarct, where you get a waxy kidney, what are all the hyla structures, and what are the conditions where you get the flea bitten kidney, so on and so forth. Appearances of the tumors, from where will you give the bits, how does it spread, and so on, it will go on. So I hope you people are a little familiar with the lesions. Your feedback and support is very much solicited. Everything is pathology except for indifference. And with this, we come to the end of today's journey, but it is bound to continue. A beautiful novel by Stephen Thomas, but the class is by Shivashekar.